the top rhetoric about Trump. It's, they just can't help themselves. They have to go over the top on every element. So here's Whoopi Goldberg talking about Donald Trump. And it's not just that she disagrees with what Trump is doing. Donald Trump is now, you guessed it, the Taliban.
We have a leader who has repeatedly demeaned women,
right,
wants to defund organizations that benefit women, calling on the media to shut up, specifically wants to give preferential treatment based on religion. Are these values really much different than the Taliban's?
I mean...
Yes, they are. It turns out that Donald Trump is not the Taliban. He's not in favor of honor killings. Donald Trump, in fact, it's to stop the Taliban from coming in the country that he's implementing some of these immigration policies. That is the basic idea behind all of this, and I'd be very surprised if in the future his immigration moratorium does not extend to Afghanistan. Okay, the fact is, Donald Trump's entire stated purpose with regard to stopping an influx of immigrants from countries like Yemen and Somalia is because he doesn't want the culture of certain areas of the world infiltrating. What he means by that is radical Islam. It's not a Muslim ban, because radical Islam and Islam are not the same thing. But it is an attempt to fight the infiltration of radical Islam into the West. So no, Donald Trump is not like the Taliban. The idea that Donald Trump is the Taliban because he is, at least in policy, pro-life. The idea that Donald Trump is the Taliban because Donald Trump doesn't want me to pay for your contraceptives. The idea that Donald Trump is the Taliban because Donald Trump is undertaking immigration reform that is in large part moderate. I mean, it really is. Again, of the 10 most populous Muslim countries on earth, 9 of them are still able to send whoever they want to the United States. Citizens from those countries can enter. And there are going to be lots of exceptions to Donald Trump's new immigration policy. The Democrats cannot help themselves. The left has to, they have to portray Donald Trump as Satan more than Satan. And there is something here that I think is kind of fascinating. And that is on both sides of the aisle, there's a tendency to attribute to the other side some sort of masterful genius. So on the left, instead of them just saying, Donald Trump, kind of incompetent, doing some things I don't like, meh, right? Which is, if you're a leftist, that's sort of what you would be saying if you're a relatively rational leftist at this point. Donald Trump is doing things I don't like, but man, he really doesn't even know what he's doing. I mean, this is pretty incompetent. That's what, if I were on the left, that's what I would be saying at this point. But instead of doing that, they have to attribute to Donald Trump satanic, all-knowing power. Right, Donald Trump is secretly the Taliban. He's secretly Hitler. He secretly has a plan to take over everything and run it. Ooh. Right? And on the right, we used to do the same thing with Obama. It wasn't just that Obama was incompetent in the rollout of Obamacare. It was all part of his evil plan. Right? Everything that Obama did was all part. It was all part of the plan. Right? It was all part of this evil, evil plan. Here's the truth. Most of the people in government suck at their jobs. Because most people in America suck at their jobs. Most adults suck at everything. Okay, the great lie of being an adult is that other adults know what they're doing. They generally don't. We all sort of muddle through, and then we hope for the best. The same is true in government. Because we attribute this level of mastery to government, we think it matters so much who heads the government, and when someone we like is in charge, we want that person to have more power. Because after all, if he's our side, we think he's the master of the universe, right? So when Donald Trump botched this executive order rollout, he had people saying it's 4D chess. It's 4D chess. No, it's not 4D chess. Okay, if it's 4D chess, it's the kind of 4D chess like in Star Wars where you don't play chess with the Wookiee because he gets mad and rips out your arms. Right? It's not actually Donald Trump playing four-dimensional chess in time, right? That's not what's going on here. But because there are so many people who have a religious belief that our leaders know what they're doing, they say give them more power, they know what they're doing. It hasn't been true for 100 years. We've muddled through anyway, but it hasn't been true for 100 years. You want to actually have a better country? Stop treating the people in government as though they're experts and know what they're doing all the time with evil plans or good plans, and just say, you know what? Whether they're evil, whether they're good, let's just cut the power of government totally, and then it won't matter because they're incompetent. It won't matter if they're evil. It won't matter if they're good. They can't do anything, right? What I would prefer is if we treated Washington, D.C. like it was the DMV and took as much power away as humanly possible, okay? Everybody is trying to turn Donald Trump into Darth Vader on the left. And on the right, everybody tried to turn Barack Obama into Darth Vader. And I think Obama was in many ways more competent than Trump is at a lot of things. And I think he had more plans than Trump does. I think Trump is pretty ad hoc. But Obama wasn't in charge of things either. It turns out very few people are actually Darth Vader. Very few people are actually capable of being Darth Vader. And so that means that we should actually take power away from them. And if you're really that worried about Darth Vader, by the way, on the left, if you're really that worried about Donald Trump being Darth Vader, how about this? Instead of him running the empire, let's downsize the empire so it's just the Mos Eisley DMV. And then you don't have to worry about it. That'd be the easiest way to fix this problem. Meanwhile, the left demonstrates that they do, in fact, have complete Trump derangement syndrome. So Jeanine Pirro of Fox News was on The View. How is Jeanine Pirro get to be on The View and I don't get to be on The View? What is the deal here, guys? Okay, what is this? I've been begging you to book me on The View for literally years at this point. Now, I understand you don't want to have me on The View. I get you don't want to have me on The View because it's going to get weird and ugly. But that's the whole point. Don't you want it to be good TV? So anyway, they have Jeanine Pirro on, and it does get weird and ugly. So Jeanine Pirro says to Whoopi Goldberg that she has Trump derangement syndrome, which is clearly true. And things get wild.
Wait, here's my question for you, because
Trump
you talk about...
I am not, Judge.
Did you just point at me?
Yes!
Listen, I don't have Trump derangement. Let me tell you what I have.
Okay, and then she, it gets crazier from there. Whoopi eventually goes so nuts that she essentially throws Jeanine Pirro off the set because Jeanine Pirro says that Whoopi Goldberg has Trump derangement syndrome, which she clearly does. Here's Whoopi Goldberg losing her mind, saying, I'm done, and then bringing this nutty segment to a crashing halt.
You know what's horrible?
What's horrible?
When the President of the United States whips up
cities.
People to beat the hell out of people.
No.
Say goodbye.
Let me buy.
Okay, and so it ends like that. But then it gets even worse. So Jeanine Pirro was on Sean Hannity's radio show the other day, and Jeanine Pirro explains what happened directly after that little tiff.
When I went off the stage, Sean, I was walking downstairs, and I said something like, Whoopi, I fought for victims my whole life, and she came at me as I was leaving, and she said, F you, in my face, literally spitting at me. F you, get the F out of this building.
Okay, so obviously she does not have Trump derangement syndrome, Whoopi Goldberg. Obviously she's a completely sane person, having normal political discourse. This is the level to which things have sunk. Okay, the level to which, I think Whoopi Goldberg is representative of a hardcore base of leftists. That this is how they feel, that anyone who disagrees with them is an evil, evil human being. And you can't even have a discussion about the issues. Now look, Jeanine Pirro is a very pro-Trump guest. There's no question. But they knew that when they booked her. If you're going to have Jeanine Pirro on, you at least have to let her talk. This idea that you bring on a guest and you don't let them talk is so beyond absurd to me. I don't understand it at all. When we do our Sunday specials here on The Ben Shapiro Show, one of the things that I do is I bring in people who disagree. I brought in Sam Harris. I brought in Eric Weinstein. I bring in people from the left all the time. We invite tons of leftist guests who won't even come because they don't want to do an interview. And I let them talk for like 15 minutes at a stretch. Because you want to know what they think, so then you can critique what they think. But the left has decided that even having these conversations is to grant credibility to a side so evil that they must not be heard. And Whoopi Goldberg has a slot on that show every single day. Everybody in the audience knows what Whoopi Goldberg thinks about these things. Wouldn't it behoove Whoopi Goldberg and the folks on The View to at least let Jeanine Pirro make her point of view known? Especially because you know the audience is going to laugh at Jeanine Pirro anyway. Because it's a View audience. It demonstrates real cowardice. Props to Bill Maher. Bill Maher had me on a couple of weeks ago. And props to Bill Maher, who actually let me talk. We had a reasonable conversation. We disagreed about nearly everything. His audience was against me. He acknowledged that at the very beginning. And then we had a reasonable conversation. Good for people like Bill Maher, really. Because there are very few of these folks left in American discourse. And Whoopi Goldberg and Joy Behar on The View demonstrate it pretty much every day. It's really, really quite pathetic.
Go read the complaint. Bullet point number one on page one of the complaint. What does the so-called whistleblower says? What does he say? Over the past 4 months, more than half a dozen U.S. officials formed the basis of this effort and this complaint that he's filing. I want to know who those more than half a dozen officials are. We want to call them as witnesses, it's tough to determine someone's credibility if you don't know who they are and you can't put them under oath and ask them questions. Everyone should know that.
What about Mr. Vindman's concerns that he raised in his opening statement that the ask to investigate the Bidens was... could potentially undermine national security. What's your reaction to that?
My reaction is always to say what I said this morning. There are four fundamental facts that have never changed. Never changed. Mr. Vindman is not the first one we've talked to who has been on the call. We've heard from President Trump and President Zelensky. We got the transcript. Both President Trump and President Zelensky said no conditions, no pressure, no pushing, no quid pro quo. We've got the transcript that shows that. We know the Ukrainians did not know at the time of the call that aid had been withheld. And tell me what action President Zelensky or the Ukrainians took to get the aid turned back on. Did he do a press conference? Did he issue a statement? Did he say he was going to investigate and do certain things? None of that happened. Those four facts have never changed. Even though you got all this stuff that Adam Schiff wants to talk about and leak from these depositions, these are all just, that's all it is. None of the basic things have ever changed.
The meeting never happened. The meeting that the Ukrainians wanted did not happen. And he raised concerns, Vindman raised concerns that did not happen. Amid this push for an investigation into the Bidens. That was a concern he raised with the National Security Council lawyer.
President Zelensky and President Trump met at the United Nations.
But he said the meeting that they were trying to get this meeting. It didn't happen.
President Trump and President Zelensky met at the United Nations. Yeah, I don't.
And the money was released.
Yeah.
Well, one point I think that needs to be made on top of what Jim said just happened today. Adam Schiff, among many things, has been trying to claim that this is a fair process by saying that Republicans are allowed to ask questions. Now, he gets to choose all the witnesses and him and himself only, which means it's not a fair process on the face. But even his claim now that Republicans can ask questions has been undermined because now he's directing witnesses not to answer questions that he doesn't.